in the LCK until Split 2 if they make it in after those relegation matches. But let's jump straight into Champion Select. Longzhu back on the blue side and banning that Malzahar once again. As Camille's going to go. I bet your bottom dollar that Varus and Ash are going to follow this Camille.
And I'm not going to agree with you. I think maybe we'll see Kongdoo mix it up here because it didn't feel like the double AD ban worked for the final game. We're seeing MC on the right, the Kongdoo coach, checking his notes, double-checking. The Ash does come through. That, of course, has been the champion that Prey has been playing. He hasn't played the 7.5 Varus just yet. We'll wait and see if we do see the double AD ban.
Might be the Lucian to take the Varus's place, potentially.
Might be a Lucian first pick.
Oh, Longzhu actually going to be the ones to ban it away.
We're getting crazy, boys.
So many AD carries and so little ban space.
And now Kongdoo basically are in an interesting spot because a lot open. Only supports, Camille, and AD carries have been banned. So a lot of champions are up, and now Kongdoo are saying, wait, are they going to first pick an AD, or are we giving over something that we do not have the tech to go against? They will ban Graves, so Varus is now available as a first pick, but Rengar is there, which of course was very strong for Crash in the last game. Will Longzhu pull a fast one, or will they just lock in the Varus to give Prey some utility carry potential? I want to see not Varus because I love watching Prey in full flight, but it will just be Prey on Varus for now.
And Varus does play a little bit more, I guess, like that evolution now with the more Blade of the Ruin King oriented build, with the Hurricanes wanting to get a little bit more in amongst it, not just standing back, throwing out arrows and relying on Chains of Corruption, things like that. So maybe an opportunity for Prey to continue to go off. Saw other players certainly getting into the thick of it on the Varus and doing phenomenal things, but Kongdoo going to take away the Ezreal. Pretty standard stuff as Punch locks away the Lee Sin for his third game in a row. That does leave, you know, Rengar and Nautilus available if Longzhu wanted to go to it.
It'd honestly be a surprise if they didn't draft both. I think Rengar Nautilus is exactly the draft you want in this spot. And they will take both of them.
So now, easy.
On the side of Kongdoo Monster, probably just looking at support. A lot of supports available, not the Zyra that's been so highly prized in this series. They could also answer a top lane. Could take Rumble here if Roach is actually feeling comfortable enough to play it. Ezio Anami is the SKT bot lane special.
Yep, also sort of sticking with that, leaving our solo lanes to decide who we want to counterpick.
And I do appreciate that it's now getting back to the point where it's like, well, the Rumble players play Rumble and everyone else is not just over-forcing Rumble.
Yep.
He does get lane priority, but if you can't play around Rumble, you lose a lot of the value of Rumble going into the mid to late game. So we have seen teams that don't have Marin and Smeb, and Huni as well, move away from the Rumble pick a lot more.
Most certainly. Prophet also, fantastic on that that Rumble pick as well. As Syndra is going to be banning away.
I hope we see some Rumble in the second series. Marin and Smeb.
Oh, we are going to see so much Rumble on the ban list, Pup Smithy. That is going to be pretty incredible. As Fly, a lot of respect given to his Orianna play for the fourth time. Game number two.
I mean, it's worth noting that this isn't just let's ban Orianna because he played good on Orianna. It's also, well, it's Rengar Nautilus again, so the ball carriers are as powerful as possible. So Ori fits that comp super well. No ban towards the Shen. Actually banning away the Cassiopeia, interestingly, does mean that Shen is available as a first pick for Kongdoo. They will counterpick mid lane.
Now, we know that Kongdoo Monster, like Edge especially, does have a lot of options. Talia still available.
Yeah, Talia or Ryze.
Ahri also there, and Ryze certainly up.
Fly hates Ahri, let's be clear. He will not play Ahri. But Ryze or Talia are both really good with pick comps, and the 1-3-1 was what Longzhu was playing almost exclusively for a couple of weeks there.
Yeah.
Now we're just waiting on either support or top lane. Could go for the Kennen, which was banned away in game one in this spot.
Ooh, very good point.
But it felt like they got a bit too tricky for their own good when they went for the Gangplank.
Oh my goodness, the Sona Varus lane is so toxic, but it's not gonna happen. It's gonna be the Karma. Oh, would have loved to see that Sona Varus.
What an epic fall from going from a dirty Alistar picker in spring last year to a dirty Karma picker this
year. I know, what a dirty Karma picker as well. I mean, so many times has Gorilla played this champion. This is going to be his 17th so far.
Now just on Kongdoo to look to the mid lane and hey, there
it
is. Wow,
all right. So the Nerf LeBlanc is going to be picked this time around. We saw a permaband at the beginning of the season.
Nerf came through for 7.5 and I believe only Kuzan has played the reworked LeBlanc. See a bit of it in EU and North America as well. So it can be a very strong split pusher. So I wonder if you will go teleport to match the 1-3-1 from Fly. This was always seen as a containment matchup for the Ryze. If you don't fall desperately behind early, you can win out on trades against the LeBlanc. But Ryze has been nerfed also on this patch. It'll be interesting to see that standard matchup again. And Edge played an excellent LeBlanc, specifically when he went over to IEM and crushed on the pick. Let's see if he can channel that in what may be, or what actually is, the final regular season game of Kongdoo Monsters 2017 Spring.
Yeah, and if they're going to go out, they want to go out with a bang. So this is their opportunity to most certainly do that. But she took such a hit. It's not a hit to her pushing ability, so she can still kill minions just as effectively. But that W does not hit champions very good at all anymore.
But it's still a strong 1-3-1 pick. Pushes better in the 1-3-1 or more. Easily. In teamfights, she took a big nerf because of the way her distortion actually did a lot of the damage in teamfights to do the incidental damage apart from the focus fire. So teamfights, sure, it's a nerf, but in the 1-3-1, which remember Longzhu set up for, might actually be able to, with Snowball, do very well.
Well, we'll see whether they can actually get that one to work out. The bottom lane now for Longzhu looking very, very powerful. We'll see exactly what they can get done as we get onto the Rift, game number 3. Okay, welcome to our final game of our first set of the evening and Kongdoo's final for the spring split of LCK 2017. All of Longzhu actually down towards the bottom side, but Kongdoo Monsters just playing cool, calm, and collected.
I get the pick, though. Does give Kongdoo Monsters other members on the map big advantage when it comes to getting deep vision. They know that everyone's on the bot side. This is some excellent caricatures from the audience. There was a gorilla one a moment ago.
Yeah, it was very, very cute. Liked it. Now Fly having a dance. Haven't seen the Dark Crystal Ryze quite some time.
Was banned for a while. I know it was on the banned skins list for a long time.
Good to see him back.
Koi Nami having some fun as well.
Yeah. Nami with Nemo, always good. That is not the right emote spam, by the way, for Nami.
That's true, actually. You can be really tilting with the laugh, I believe it is.
You can trigger someone pretty hard with that one. Thankfully, Guga not going to be doing that to us. We'll see how Kongdoo Monster go with this SKT special on the bottom side of the map.
When it comes to the mid lane, the new first time I've been able to cast the 7.5 LeBlanc. A lot of little changes to her. Q-Max is now the staple. People speculated, would it be Q into E and just giving up on the W because he lost 100 base damage on the ability, but QW does seem to be the way that people have been maxing it. So it's still going to get that lower cooldown so you can dart in and out of fights.
Yeah, more about the mobility rather than the damage now on the distortion.
But from level 7, you can basically full clear minion waves very happily with W into Q, as you now have 80% bonus damage to the monster. So the pushing is still there, and that's why 1-3-1, she can be powerful, and Edge might try to do both as he has the Ignite, so he does have lane pressure, but when it comes to global pressure, it's going to be smart rotations rather than the teleport that I thought maybe he'd be going for. Kuzan, when he was playing on 7.5, was running teleport LeBlanc.
Yep, just trying to be a little bit more tricksy around the map. See where it is going to be cute in the Qs as well. It could be an opportunity with the Deceive. Now that it works just a little bit differently. Sort of was ignored for a little while just because she was just so strong, so you didn't really need to worry about it. Maybe some funny business to happen with the possible split push antics that you were talking about, Papa Smith.
Crash playing on this inside of the jungle. Take the blasting cone over. No, actually warded over. Didn't have a blasting plant. So just warded over to take away the Krugs. Nautilus pushing up. Jungler invading. Very standard stuff for Longzhu, but good to see.
Yep.
Waiting for Expression to pull off the triple Dorans.
Oh, yes.
The Nautilus special.
Budget rower, as you like to call it, Pop Smithy.
That's cheap, man.
Yeah.
So the low price of a Catalyst, actually maybe, wait, is Catalyst 1100 now? It might be. 1200 gold, you get a lot of stats.
Pretty close, but Expression gonna have to go for the Fat Flash. Actually not going to opt into it. He may even just die here before using it. And he will. Just decides that the summer spell is worth the first blood.
Awkwardly punch, had the Q on him and had the resonating strike available, so he would have been followed over if he went for the max range flash, so decided that he can overextend next time with a couple of Doran's rings and have the flash available for that. I think on balance is probably the smart decision.
Yep.
If the Q was down, definitely you go for the flash, but because the Q was up, probably smart to hold on to the flash.
Maybe an opportunity to get a flash staggering blows as well to possibly lock down Roach for a kill onto Crash.
Are you going to enjoy this double marked minion wave lane?
Oh, yes.
All the minions get marked very frequently.
Especially when it means that they die really, really quickly. And it just feels really satisfying. Oh, no, we have another minion mortality conversation.
We are.
Because that was just a really brutal sentence, and I didn't mean it. I'm sorry, minions. Fly, taking a lot of damage. His punch makes his way in with the safeguard. Chains are going to land, but immediate cleanse from Fly.
Get the summoner advantage, though, so Kongdoo not able to force the summoner, but get the first blood in top lane and then blow both summoners from Fly in mid lane. Can't even cleanse the ignite, so the kill pressure goes up there as well.
Yeah. In goes Edge. Doesn't find the chain, but doesn't really matter. We'll have that one back up in a few seconds. Is Gorilla going to poke his head in the river? Just trying to convince Punch to leave. Bit of extra damage there with the Mantra Q. Fly happy to play up. So still same farm, but it's whether Punch can get back into that lane and punish the lack of summoner spells that he will be suffering for the next few minutes.
Kind of fun that the bot lane plays out very differently between Ezreal and the Varus. You know, previously, these were both tier stackers, but no longer tier is the core build for the Varus. So first item purchase is going to be a big lead for Prey as he works towards what we can only imagine will be Blade the Ruined King Hurricane.
Yeah, pretty standard stuff now for the Varus. Whereas Sol has a few extra options now with the Ezreal. We've been seeing a little bit of mix-up. He may actually opt into for something like the Sheen for extra trade power and forego the really early tier. Maybe
he was greedy
for lane.
He was greedy when we saw it last time, though. Did go the tier boots route when he had gold for Sheen. So no guarantees on that.
Still flexible. And I like that, especially when a champion is not just cookie cutter. You don't build the same thing every single time. It's about understanding what you need to pick up at the particular situation. Roach is going to teleport back top. Speshen already used his. He's on a bit of a walkabout down the river. There's Guga struggling. Prey going to get bubbled, but not going to take too much. That's only a double bounce on the ebb and flow. So we're not feeling too super good about that.
No health pots for Gorilla, though, so that's why you have to be careful with these trades, because Nami only now can we pop in the last biscuit. Health lead for Kongdoo Monster.
Fly getting double chained here by Edge. Nicely done. Good mimic use, and very quickly there by Edge just to assert dominance in that lane.
Honestly, the saddest thing about the evolution of the mimic use, because people realize that mimic is best used to block skill shots rather than actually to cause the map-wide disruption that I think the build, that the change was envisioned for. So you almost never see the LeBlanc, the Phantom LeBlanc coming bot lane and drawing
scaring
a flash.
Scaring you into doing stuff, yeah.
It's more just to block a queue from the Ryze.
A bit sad. I'd like it for the use, like, I don't know, put it in the mid lane and just let people assume that you're still there and stuff like that.
I think that's really cool. If you just distortion walking down to bot lane for a gank, then have it come to mid lane and distort onto the enemy champion while you're ganking.
Yeah.
We've actually never seen that done in LCK, but I always was excited about the potential for it.
There are a lot of really cool potential things, but
blocking an overload is pretty good too.
Yeah, damn right. And if like, and that's a little bit more consistent as well. I mean, sometimes with these mind games, the risk-reward factor is not something that you necessarily want to be going for.
One of the reasons why the original Ryze, you know, without skill shots, needed to be changed is that if ever a champion with no skill shots is at the power level of a champion with skill shots, why not go for the champion with no skill shots? Because at the end of the day, you know, you'll have that reliability even if it's just 52%. It's an extra thing to give yourself. So that's why you see now almost no targeted abilities for ranged champions, only ultimates.
Yep.
Skill shots are plenty. make things a little bit easier to balance.
And even with ultimates, I mean, what is it? Like, Malzahar?
Malzahar ult, for sure. And guess what? We see a whole lot of Malzahar, even though his laning has now been nerfed almost exclusively.
Close to Oblivion. Fly still demanding some respect here in this mid lane, even though Edge does have level advantage with a whole minion wave heading towards him. But the two items that Fly was looking for have been purchased. He's on the road to Bean Rise.
Might be this Protobelt Lichbane build from Edge that saw play in Europe.
Cute. So like an Echo, but you're not Echo.
Does mean that you've got three dashes, potentially, with the Mimic Distortion into the Protobelt, although you're almost exclusively mimicking your Q with how things have changed.
Yep.
And the Lichbane helps with the Spit Push, of course, which has been a lot about what this current LeBlanc is for.
Yeah. I like, you know, just buying a Lichbane on random mid laners that still do like the AP, because it's never a bad thing to have your auto attacks be better. And when you can take down a turret very effectively, it's always a good idea, as Edge. You get a fair bit of damage. Once again, the Mimic has been used. Just to block out some of those bad damage, like you were mentioning before, Papa Smitty. But yeah, I mean, it was the old Ambition thing. I believe it was Ambition that used to play Lichbane Ahri. Just split push. Wasn't a thing that was used before, but does work.
The first Lichbane Ahri we saw was Many Reason on Zenix Storm a very long time ago. We're talking about Season 1, Season 2 of Champions. And a couple of other people played around it. Faker was building it in solo queue during the Worlds run as a potential counter to... I was really sad we never saw the GOP Lichbane Ahri as a counter pick to Syndra. Turns out Banning was pretty good at dealing with Syndra as well.
Yep,
although Crown couldn't play it, so that was kind of an issue.
All of the analysts learning about this.
I just saw it and I was like, we need to talk about this. He keeps picking it into specifically Syndra.
I think I remember it was Spawn who was most upset. He was like, oh, I put in so much time into learning about this. And then it just never happened. That is what happens, though. You know, sometimes all of that prep that you do.
You got to skull solo queue once in a while because you just see things. It's like we saw, I believe it was Doinby playing mid lane Kled. In LPL, and I've been seeing that as a trend in Korea. When Talon was first picked up by Fly, it was the first Talon we had this season, hadn't been played in any other region. It was already a permaban in Korean solo queue, so Korean solo queue especially does have those one tricks that can pull off some new stuff that ends up going to competitive.
Yep. The Fizz as well, another one. As a Realm Walk is going to come in, but Fly just hopping over a wall. Find anything there at all. Possibly this Mountain Drake being considered by Longzhu, but Sol's going to make his way up the river. Guga's there already as well. Crash, you don't need to do that anymore.
Hasn't really had any thrilling hunts. Hasn't really done any hunting at all in this particular game.
Not been many thrills sort of regardless, to be perfectly honest. Punch, of course, picking up First Blood was something that was fun up towards the top side of the map, but otherwise, ain't nothing going on.
Wave clear.
Yeah.
Worth noting that Fly only 5 CS behind and will even delay his own Rod of Ages by picking up the non-magic mantle.
Yep.
Scaling game being played by both sides to some degree.
I really like the non-magic mantle pickup as well, because if Guga's going to come up, I mean, that's extra magic damage. Sol, of course, at this stage of the game is going to be doing a fair bit of magic damage with Essence Flux still being kind of relevant.
Electron Cloak will help here in the trades.
Yep. Edge having to use that Mimic there once again to block some damage as Punch is going to turn up a little bit late to this party but misses the Q. Out of character for him, actually, this series.
Yeah, Fly still had flash ups, didn't want to look for a kick flash, knew it would have been disrespect flash and wouldn't have been able to get a big advantage there. Back to laning phase.
But thankfully for Fry, Fly, of course, has both of his summoner spells back available, didn't have to use them there in that exchange.
Teamfight-wise, it seems like Longzhu will have a pretty significant advantage, but you're not willing to ink the contract on that just because, sure, LeBlanc teamfight has been straight up nerfed, but Ezreal and the separating factor between two teams, and when the first round of CC is down, we'll be able to skirt the outsides of a team fight.
Not to mention Nami as well. Well-placed Tidal Wave and Bubble can really change the fate of a team. Oh my goodness, Sol in trouble.
He's crashed.
Crash. Yeah, the thrilling hunt that you were referencing before, Papa Smithy.
Not popped yet.
No, he's in fact wanting to look for Punch to possibly come past. There are a lot of pings going down. He has pulled the blue buff. They want to try and steal this one away from Edge if they can. Should be a fight for it, though. Realm Warp is going to be available. It's going to be blue buff stolen away just by Crash. Not going to try and donate it to his mid laner.
Really big for Fly in particular, because if Fly picks up blue buff, we'll have a lot of lane control in what is normally a very difficult matchup. This is one of the few windows where Edge will have significant kill pressure. He's got a bit of everything in this build. Now has those Lich Bane parts as well.
Oh yeah, I like it. Bit of an Aether Wisp sheen in a gun. As far as like things, it's like kind of like a pirate build, isn't it?
How do you figure?
Because you've got like a sword and a pistol, and then
what's an Aether Wisp in this analogy?
I don't know. Maybe it's like that's a. They I'm sure they smoke tobacco, don't they? Pirates. It's kind of like a wisp of smoke, and it's a bit magical and mystical. Pirates are kind of mystical.
I've been learning everything I know about pirates from you watching Black Sails recently.
Yeah. Oh, it's a good show. Good show. It definitely surprised me in a lot of ways.
I'm definitely not watching. I just hear the updates that you fill me in on every few episodes.
Yeah, it was just really cool that, you know, one of the main characters is John Silver, and I was like, huh, long John Silver. I think that might
have they confirmed that yet?
Yes, they have.
Oh,
bit
baby.
Of a spoiler alert. But he is, guys, long John Silver. I'm not gonna say anything more. It's worth watching if you guys like pirate politics.
Have you noticed how every show? Have you noticed that every fantasy show now has politics in it?
I know. It's like Game of Thrones. What have you done?
It can never just be about pirates.
Yeah, no,
it has to be their politics. Are there shades of grey?
No, they're not. And if there were, there'd only be a few. Oh dear. Roach happily farming things out. Does have his Tiamat there to help him with that wave clear. Not opting in for a Barmy Cinder just yet. Has that Spirit Visage to survive the lane as in goes Edge. And Fly wants to try and escape the Realm Warp. Perfect timing for that bubble just out of reach. Doesn't have to use the flash.
Speaking of flashes, Duga has to flash over.
Yeah.
As a respect to seeing Karma walk up. Didn't have vision on Varus at that split second. Knew he could be womboed down. As himself, split pushing down bottom. Got Blade the Ruin King first and big bye. Berserker Greaves and the Blade of the Ruin King means gets a decent chunk of damage into the Kongdoo outer turret. Still waiting for first brick and awkwardly Rod of Ages at the 16-minute mark.
Yeah, Fly unfortunately having to go back and only get a blasting wand always feels bad.
And now he's like, I guess I need boots and the Rod of Ages on my next back, so.
Yeah, it's like I've missed that really cool fun window of like the 12-minute Rod of Ages, so I just don't care.
This is definitely where, like, you needed to get to work at 8:30. It's like 8:43, and you're like,
yeah,
oh.
It's like, well, I'm already late. May as well be super late.
He's not even fashionably late anymore.
Yeah. Anyway, he will have it eventually. Should be fine. I do like that we've seen yet another Ezreal build this time. It's not the variety bucket. Doesn't have the Sheen, but has finished off a pretty rushed Blade of the Ruin King as Fly and Edge once again just fighting each other.
Trades are going more and more to the side of Fly, you'll see, which is a concern from Edge, who even took Ignite for kill pressure.
Yeah, hasn't been able to use it almost at all, I don't think, this game. It's been holding onto it for that opportune moment.
It's been complete, so maybe split pushing. Maybe enough of this silly rise and want to go split pushing.
Yeah.
Bot lane.
Yeah, there's a lot of buttons are going down, but Prey's getting bounced up and down in the air. Guga, Stand United is coming in. Roach should turn up relatively soon, but no! He actually gets it cancelled. That is going to be the kill going over to Prey. A disastrous sign for Kongdoo Monster fans.
And Prey continued to walk up because he got the call from Expression that he had range on the depth charge to be able to interrupt. So didn't even use a summoner, did Prey. Walked up, they registered the kill. It goes to Prey, who already had the immediate early power build. They'll turn on to Mountain Drake as well. Baron buff around 20 minutes now needs to be respected from the side of Kongdoo Monster, who want to get in the side lanes with their Lich Bane LeBlanc, put down Vision. They cannot overlook Baron pressure at 20, because Blade of the Ruin King Varus can shred that Baron.
Yeah, and like you said, I mean, it's a different LeBlanc this time around. It's the Ignite, so not going to be able to get towards that Baron all that quickly as Fly hit by the chains. Another one could potentially come down, no? Mimic was already used.
I don't know if he got his auto attack in, actually. Awkwardly. Yeah. And that would have been more damage than the Q.
One of those things where, like, you just finish a Lich Bane and you need to retrain your brain to, like, thread those auto attacks even more.
I mean, he only has the Hextech Revolver, but that's also an energized auto attack.
Oh my goodness. So many. He should have taken Warlord's Bloodlust. So energized, Papa Smithy.
He went Thunder Lords instead.
Oh, no. I guess that's somewhat energizing.
I mean, you force Ryze out
of
lane.
Oh, double bubble. What does it mean? Stunning. He's going to get Punch and Edge out of the way. However, not all that impactful. Just looked dang cool.
Double Mountain Drake are going to be the spawns. So the second Mountain Drake would be another real percentage increase to really justify an early Baron take by Longzhu.
So you're going to say string to their bow. It was going to be a cool Varus reference, and I would have liked it.
I say that too much. I was trying to say something else.
I could sort of feel you you were reaching for the string
back.
For the bow.
I pulled back, like you pull back on an arrow in a bow.
Perfect, perfect. Love it. There's Punch. There's a lot of checking each other right now, but no one really wants to go in for any fully committed engagement.
But they are checking each other with purpose.
That's true. It's Fly. He's going to check himself as well before he's wrecked by other people, not himself.
Checking with purpose and meandering are different things. They weren't meandering. There was purpose there.
Thriller actually taking a lot of damage here from Sol. That Ty Caller's Blessing doing work from Guga. Just hanging out towards the back, keeping his AD carry safe. Crash turns up.
Edge can't
down, though.
If Edge can't pull off this split push, in team fights, he needs to be the one to completely burst down Prey in particular. Prey with this build, it's not the old stay out of range, do 1,000 damage from off the screen Varus. This is auto attack Varus, so we'll be in a 575 range and potentially be picked off by a burst LeBlanc build, which is all of them.
Okay, Punch somehow gets himself the blue buff, but I'd call robbed on that one. Is double chains, not going to get any kills. Has a giggle though, so that's good. Obviously still keeping the spirits high.
Both teams playing just for their own morale. Nothing on the line for either. You could argue that Longzhu want to finish 6th to get the most circuit points, because I'm sure they will want to be in the world's gauntlet after a summer season.
Precisely. Each heightened point you can get to in the ladder certainly means something, so never means nothing to be winning as many games as you possibly can, but Kongdoo, I believe, pretty...
Kongdoo definitely have nothing but pride to play for.
Locked into the old 10th place.
Yep. 8th through 10th are locked in. Will be BBQ, Jhin Air, and Kongdoo Monster at the bottom.
Edge surprisingly picks up the Mercury's Dreads. I would have thought that just aiming for as much damage as possible would be what you'd be doing on the LeBlanc these days, but no, playing quite defensively with a Null Magic Mantle also there.
Speaking of defense, Phantom Dancer second from Prey, who has accepted that people are going to get in melee range and wants to be able to try and turn an all-in.
This is like his Ash build that he went for the other day as well, which I certainly liked. As Gorilla has to flash, taking a lot of damage, deciding to stand still as in comes the rest of Longzhu. Gorilla survives for so long, and now the Chains of Corruption fly through. Praise turned up. Sol makes his way over to the side. Edge just being tricky around this fight, but Fly is able to finish him off. Prey flashes away to safety. He is going to fall eventually, though, as the True Shot Barrage slices Longzhu down. Now Fly will fall eventually as the bubble does go wide.
Oh,
no, yeah, he's making his way out, flashes the Q, Crash wants to get in, leaps out of the brush, Crash all survives as the double kill comes down in the end, and Longzhu solidify the victory. How did that even happen?
He wrote him off Atlas, but he turned it around, still had Flash to get in position for the double kill.
I think I was justified in that one as well, but that was a comedy of errors on the side of Kongdoo to fail to lock down that Ryze, who was just had his blue suede shoes on.
He played the back end of the fight really well. I'll give respect to him rather than focus on Kongdoo. Predictably, not being at the level of some of the other teams in the league, he even walks around and takes down the outer mid lane turret. So for a guy who started his stacking late, first brick and some kills, we're going to see what was a really extended fight. And I love that you called out that Gorilla on sub 100 health lived for what, 6, 7, 8 seconds? Last auto attack wasn't energized. And we thought maybe this would be a very one-sided fight for Longzhu. It's pretty predictably juke to skill shot walking forward, but the kick was massive. Got
so
the damage
good.
And the CC. And when Prey dies to an auto attack, you think, okay, Longzhu are done. But it's only Nami and the Lee Sin. And the sidesteps from Fly, look at how many skill shots he sidesteps. Walks back into it. Crash doesn't take it out either. And can even focus on Guga because there are no cooldowns onto Punch. Crash comes in. That duo has not had the best of seasons. It felt like Crash and Fly haven't always been on the same wavelength. In that one fight, they look good.
It does make sense, though, because if you're flying, you don't want to crash. So it's not exactly synergy.
Shut up, Alice.
You walked into it. Sorry, I had to do it. But that was stunning. And it was mostly just Fly, knowing exactly where to walk at exactly the right time. And when you feel like you've been downloaded like that on the side of Kongdoo Monster, can play a big psychological game, so we'll see how they treat the rest of this in regards to that rise.
Gorilla roaming up. Second Mountain Drake we talked about. Baron's certainly getting scary. Side of Longzhu.
Yeah. Not to mention the fact that we do have the Transform coming in for that Seraph's Embrace on Fly, so he's powered up. And with this attack speed build with the Blade of the Ruined King, this is focusing on taking down these neutral objectives. You saw that Piercing Arrow didn't do a whole lot of work, but you get some stacks. Start doing that percentage damage, it is going to do some work. As Fly taking a lot here, as Seraph's Embrace has to be used. He tries to get out with the ultimate, but isn't able to.
Oh my goodness!
How is he surviving this? There's Guga taking a whole host of damage from the side. Sol, how the hell did he survive for that long? And Sol had to sacrifice himself. Prey comes in, and he's just going to play clean up here. Double kill already as Roach has to flash his way out. Oh my goodness, bought so much time did that rise.
The amount of time he's staying in the fight when Edge has to go out at the first sign of a tank coming in to potentially CC him up is the difference between the two teams. The bonus items. The stacking started at 15 minutes, but at 26, he will be an absolute monster with Abyssal Scepter completed as well. They're going to take out a turret and bot lane, and Longzhu turning around the series. Now find themselves only 2,000 gold ahead, but when you've got a scaling advantage, like the Ryze, for example, against a LeBlanc who has taken Ignite, doesn't have the split push pressure to go along with the builds, and hasn't been doing any split pushes, Longzhu in a great spot.
Yeah, sort of wondering what he's trying to do, but let's have a look at this one again as Fly goes down so low and you think maybe he's just going to die here.
Yeah, Seraph's shield gets torn and you're like, okay, he's done, but the second shield from his passive comes up. Guga doesn't have the damage to finish him off predictably as a Nami. Doesn't die to the first Q either, so he actually gets a trade, which is just ridiculous. And now Sol's completely out of position to the oncoming Prey because everyone spent so much damn time trying to kill the Ryze.
And it would have been a completely different story. If Fly hadn't have fallen down, then the rest of Kongdoo Monster wouldn't have had to get out of position. It would have been Kongdoo Monster controlling that entire space and being able to press down on Longzhu. But when Fly is just creating all of this chaos, it's just nothing that they can do. So many buttons had to be invested into one little Ryze who dodged half of them.
Calm little items certainly don't suggest that. He is now pretty monstrous, this Ryze. Yeah. Has 2,300 health, plus the overshield, plus, of course, the passive shield.
And all of that movement speed that comes from Storm Raider Surge and his passive itself. Oh, my goodness. Scary to deal with, and now Punch thinking about it. But I wouldn't almost fancy one versus two this stage.
You wonder who's going to kill the Ryze increasingly as crashes bot lane.
Yep. See whether Roach is going to be able to survive this one. His Expression and Crash just dancing over the top of him. He's just going to try and wander his way out. Of course, very, very tanky. Just wants to get that Shadow Dash over the wall if he can.
The ward
goes in, but Crash would have been able to jump to him anyway and is going to be able to secure that kill.
First kill of the game for Crash. Let's see how much damage Edge actually does with this build.
Yep, chains are going to break. And Gorilla flashes out of the way. Fly just makes his way to the mid lane and says, hey guys, what's up? Everything okay? And everything is. Apart from the flash now gone on Gorilla.
Still 2 minutes for the Rod of Ages to be completely stacked. The amount of kills he got during what should have been just a formative phase for the Ryze, what separates these two teams. Flash face checks.
Yeah. Doesn't get locked down for too long, though. Not a lot of follow-up CC after those chains connect. And once again, Crash actually trying to lock this one down. If that was old LeBlanc, that would have been Gorilla most certainly dead. But not going to die this time.
It's not a high-damage build. To be
no,
clear,
it's not.
Lich Bane Proto Belt, or Lich Bane Hextech Revolver, I guess, is Edge sort of trading with Fly.
Kind of, as he dodges the CC from the bubble, still kiting this one out as Prey makes his way through as well. There's the snare. It's Roach utilizing those Merc Treads decently well, but it's not enough. Crash locks down that kill. Edge trying to dance his way out. Punch as well, safeguarding himself over to the LeBlanc. And we'll see. It's only Roach dead, but will the Baron be an option here for Longzhu?
Definitely.
Yeah, they are going to go for it. Expression is full health.
Realm Orb available.
Very scary as Sol playing the dancing game off to the side. If he lands a good Mystic shot, could possibly try and take someone down. But the Dredge Line's there. Blazer, Fly, sorry, able to lock that one down himself. And Edge does get the chain. And Expression can't go any further forward, but it just means another one dead. Longzhu can once again start off this Baron.
It's a good call to peel off it. They'll probably do it again because Punch is alive. There still is the chance of a steal. So go for the goaltending. That's what you want to do.
Yep, Edge distorts his way in. Tidal Wave flies through, but punch. Oh my god, the Nami steals the Baron. Immediately punch falls down, but now the Realm Walk to try and get everyone. But they don't. And that is two members, three members of Kongdoo Monster with the Baron. And how many supports have stolen stuff over the last 2 weeks, man?
Only one. It's been Max, but on every different champion. And now Guger steals it with, I guess, a Q. As we watch the replay, the first time Longzhu peeled off, they don't this time. The teleport comes through, and he steals it with an Aqua Prison. He probably only had a single point in the Aqua Prison, too.
And I was talking about Nami Wave Clear. I was like, Aqua Prison's a good option. It's not. It doesn't do a lot of damage at all.
It does 75 base damage. It was probably doing about 80 damage.
Yep.
I mean, after resist, probably less than 80 damage. And he stole Baron. Okay.
Yep, fair enough. Oh, actually, no. He had an Eye of the Watcher, so it would have had plus, you know, about 100 damage.
Sure.
Smite does a heck of a lot more than that.
Crash smited. Punch couldn't. Yep. And the smite was early, and of all things to be stolen by, we're getting to silly territory when it's a level 1 Aqua Prison.
Yep. I like how we've got, what, Death Sentence, Glitter Lance, now Aqua Prison.
At least the Glitter Lance wasn't a Baron.
Yeah, that was a dragon. But still, pretty impressive.
The Threshold was perhaps the most surprising.
Yeah.
The level 1 Aqua Prism maybe beats it now.
Very silly.
Now, still Longzhu are very powerful. Bigger than the gold lead. I think it's another one of those implied gold advantages to Longzhu, like Kongdoo's advantage in game 1. Turn onto an Infernal Drake, but Kongdoo will definitely want to fight for this.
Yeah, Expression looking for the flanking play. He's standing on a ward, so Kongdoo wants to know exactly what's going on. No one to opt in for this smite fight as Crash wants to prove himself, does so nicely, and now Longzhu looking to collapse, but looks like Kongdoo Monster buying time for Roach to split his inner turret towards the top side, which should actually even out the gold if it can't even out the dragons, which is certainly in Longzhu's favor.
Got a very early Titan Hydra and actually went for Banner of Command this game to stop the Nautilus from being able to counter push.
Interesting. Realm Warp is going to get Longzhu up here to defend, so they're not going to lose that turret, but a lot of damage being put down. Edge looking for someone in transition. Ward goes over. Spot out the LeBlanc. No funny business for you.
My issue, though, for Kongdoo is how they kill the Ryze. It doesn't feel like this utility-focused split push build from the LeBlanc actually worries the Ryze. And Ryze has turned around three fights in a row to the advantage of Longzhu Gaming. That's still something they have to prove, that they actually have lethal damage to take him down.
Yeah. Is the option here for Edge, like, Void Staff into Death Cap now? Is that sort of how you have to go? Or do you want to finish that revolver into something? Like a GLP, perhaps? I don't know.
GLP is an option. Again, like the protobelt was what it was for,
right?
But as you say, it's like the protobelt timing may have... Window has definitely gone away. It's a great one-item power spike. You could argue for it second, but after that, not really getting much value. So Void Staff will definitely be the next purchase, and I guess situational.
Yeah.
For the LeBlanc.
Interesting to speculate. Expression comes down to try and defend this outer turret. It will be difficult. The tank battle's there, but the Bash Brothers in Crash and Expression should be able to once again take down Roach. Death Charge flies through. He's just not as tanky as
he wants away,
to be.
Though.
Yeah, I was trying to. Yeah. Okay, all of the CC is gone. Yeah. How you do that against a Nautilus is difficult.
Well, the auto attack is a snare, remember. It is not something that interrupts. In this particular case, that particular auto attack, so couldn't stop it. Roach gets away. They take an objective as well. Dagger and blow, for once not enough.
Yeah, sad. And I guess you do front load all of your CC at your own peril, the really tanky Shen. Tidal Wave gonna be dodged, but just buying some space. Good zoning ultimate. Might be able to get them the turret here as Kongdoo Monster looking to try and get something done. Roach gets himself through. Yeah, Prey's going to fall first. Turret, of course, falling down as Fly wants to get through. Redemption for the full heal. Punch still somewhat low, but 2/3 health is fine for the Lee Sin, who doesn't have the ultimate remaining.
They don't have the luxury of having Fly in another lane than Prey, because Prey has no mobility. And Fly is the one that has most of the gold this game. So Kongdoo saw Fly in another lane, just ran straight at Prey. What's a boy to do? Take him down. And there's only two damage threats. Sure, Rengar's doing decent damage, but he wasn't grouped either. Longzhu feels like they lost the maximum. What was still feeling like Longzhu were completely in control and the gold lead was just a bit of an aberration is suddenly starting to feel like Kongdoo Monster are still squarely in game 3.
Yeah, we were talking about this LeBlanc low damage build. Now with that Void Staff done, feeling like That damage is getting more and more relevant, especially onto the squishy targets. Thankfully, Prey does have a Hex Drinker, but it didn't save him last time. And it's going to be all about Fly and what he can get done continuing through this game, because the Ryze is so important. He's got so many of the kills, so much of the money, so many items.
It's a death cap short of his 6-item build, which this early in the game is very frightening.
It does look like a greedy build, because it's like, come on, how many Wizard Staves do you need? He's got like 4 in there.
No one would argue with this Ryze that he was a wizard.
Yeah, he's most certainly a wizard.
Gold being traded in terms of outer turrets on both sides of the map, but not moving anyone else forward. I love the build from Roach, who feels tanky enough to start building team utility. First he went Banner of Command, has good selfish stats, but is mostly about stopping the Expression Split Push, and now the Knight's Vow that has become more and more common on 7.5. Ixu was the first to build it twice in a series and talked about how he really felt like the item was in a great place. And now, seeing it earlier and earlier, given that it gives good selfish stats, but also makes your AD carry that much stronger.
Yeah, and it feels cool that it's sort of a support item on first look, but does fit top lane very effectively.
And it's fun that both sides are doing something, because remember, the auto attacks on the AD carry are healing up the tank as well, so they're both interacting.
Of course, in a meta when there's a lot of caster supports, it's also not as important to have it on your support player, and a lot of that tanking capability necessary from your top lane. Do like it.
If you die instantly, Knight's Vow doesn't really help you.
Yeah, pretty bad.
Does true damage, so even Alistair's like, I'm not 100% sure. My ult got nerfed. Weird that he goes between English and saying the word moo.
Well, sometimes you just gotta say moo.
Go back to your base nature.
Yeah, it's like meow. Meow can say meow.
It's like us saying mate too much.
Yeah, but we shouldn't do that. No. You know, we've gotta steer clear from these colloquialisms.
That's true. Cut away the hard edges of our Australian accents.
Precisely. Goes Edge. Does land the chains on a crash. If they get this lockdown, it could be a big deal, as the next Baron has just spawned. 30 seconds on the dragon there as well. Will be that Elder Dragon.
Longzhu lose this series to a Nami Aqua Prison Baron buff steal. That would be a tilter.
That would be the Max Dream.
Are we talking about the support player or you, Max Atlas Anderson?
Most certainly the support player from MVP. Because it's what he does. Steal stuff from his opponents.
Sure. Don't really have a flank ward anymore. I felt like Nautilus could show up pretty much ad nauseum, but they see both those flank wards in the future, at least, with these double lane wards. So they most likely will not overextend with the Nautilus being able to teleport there. They don't have other options, so for now, they do not have Expression with a natural path to get backline access onto Seoul.
And it looks like Longzhu are pretty content just pushing up this mid lane, having Expression split push. Seems like Kongdoo Monster are the ones sort of moving around, trying to test the waters, figuring out where they can possibly get their next engage, making the proactive plays, but it is eventually going to work out as long as you move towards this mid lane and take down this inner turret.
As long as you get the 5v5 they're looking for with Nautilus engaging and Ryze machine gunning, they will win it.
Yes.
That part is clear, but Kongdoo Monster want to run them around the map, and having a vision advantage, one of the best ways to do that. They still do have good catches, LeBlanc. Doesn't really matter which ability power items. When you get closer and closer to 6, she will be doing very respectable damage.
Cutting through someone. Maybe not Expression, who does have a lot of health.
Probably not Fly with any speed.
Yes, true. Especially when Fly just seems to be able to dodge away from almost any skill shot.
We've seen the tank build come through from Prey. Almost certainly going to be Bloodthirster with that BF Sword as Fly's caught.
Completely out of position there as well, and will be eventually taken down this time. Soul locks him up. What was he even doing there? As Roach is ignoring Expression, the Banner of Command, of course, took so long to take down. Now Kongdoo Monster should easily be able to grab this Baron with so much of the money now off the map.
They just had no vision around the area, and I talked about how Kongdoo had the wards for picks. Longzhu didn't have defensive vision, and Crash has given up on the hope of claiming this Baron. Should certainly be going over to Kongdoo Monster, and the first one was sheer roll of the dice. The second one is cool, calm, and calculated by Kongdoo Monster, and this might actually be their third match win of the year.
Beautiful stuff. As Elder Drake looking to be snowballed towards as well. We'll see where the Kongdoo monster can easily take this one down. Remember, Longzhu could possibly collapse towards the area. 10 seconds remains on fly, though, and they don't want to go 4v5. Free Elder Drake, free Baron, all from one positional advantage, one vision control advantage. The Kongdoo monster were able to lock down.
You have to say, Kongdoo have read two situations that have kind of turned this game. The Baron Steel is not what I'm talking about, but seeing Fly, clearing minions in the top lane, running straight at Prey, nothing a Varus can do, taking him down. That got them one advantage, and then just pushing up their vision, catching Fly. Those two catches have separated the two teams. They've gotten these big advantages to get off. Also, the luckiness of stealing away a Baron in such comical fashion. And Fly has all the gold. Fly is the power on the side, as it was actually in Vindy Edge. So for a bit of damage on the side of Varus as a sixth item.
Yeah.
But it needs to be Fly and Prey. It cannot be one or the other. And so far, they haven't really been able to expertly use both those damage threats. And that means the Kongdoo now once again ahead.
Yeah. That Shatter Orb was also incredibly satisfying from Edge. Thank you very much for that one, sir. Needlessly large rod completed. Decided to sell that revolver, so that was just a bit of an early game option. Oh no, he didn't! What the heck? That is a Hextech Gunblade!
It is.
Okay! I'm having a good time with this build. Well, I joke about that all the time, and the one time it bloody happens, I have a goddamn joke.
Well, it does give him Life Leech from, I don't know how much the inherent spell vamp is, it shoots
and
Fly.
And you can shoot Fly with it, and the chains are going to land there as well. Seraph's Embrace, not
dead.
Enough. Guga grabs the kill once again. He can still kill Rises and Barons with that Aqua Prison. No worries at all. Prey, not going to find the Chains of Corruption.
He's going to take the base.
Most certainly are. We'll see whether they can actually push this all the way through.
They're going to try.
Baroned up minions are certainly here. And look at this damage. The LeBlanc has a gun. This is insane. Now, 4 versus 4, I guess, as in goes Edge. He's got the stands united. He has been exhausted for a moment, but
it's not going to
last for too long. There's Prey kiting around as best he can. Punch off on his own. Gets the kick eventually as Edge is able to pick up the kill.
Expansion. No damage.
Melting. This is ridiculous. Double kill coming down from Edge's Expansion. A last-ditch effort, but it's going to be Kongdoo Monster upsetting Longzhu in game number 3, and in beautiful fashion as well. I mean, we were doubting all sorts of things, but off the back of a Nami bubble, they are going to be able to take down this team and make the best impression heading towards that promotion tournament.
Felt like an act of God when Aqua Prison level 1 stole away the Baron. But from there, some smart moves from Kongdoo and just brazen overextensions from Longzhu are well punished, and with nothing to play for, cannot even move to ninth place. We're actually going to get our first team interview of the season, as it's Kongdoo Monster's last game and they end on a high. In a 7-day span, they beat Katie Rolster and Longzhu. And if this gets the feelings high, because remember, this is a team who has looked down and out for so much of the season, 9 to 10 weeks of the season.
Almost since their inception, Papa Smith.
That's kind of the scary thing, is they've looked down and out. We've seen so many games where no one's talking, everyone has sullen faces, even the coach hasn't really had many choice words after some of their 2-0 losses. They are on their highest ebb exactly when they need it. If they can parlay this into staying in the LCK, maybe they can throw out the bathwater that was the spring season and make a run for summer, because great stuff for them. And unfortunately for Longzhu, feels a lot like the last Longzhu squad we saw with Coco, Chaser, all the members of 2016. This looked like the right mix. They had a lot of power on the roster, but largely squandered, and now face the kind of infamous result of losing to Kongdoo again, and may even finish 7th or 8th, and that might come to hurt them, even if they have a really powerful summer season.
Yeah, this is the problem, is that, you know, those points where you can get them feel the best, but it's just not happening for Longzhu with a performance like that. They still do have one more match remaining against KT, but after this, I mean, you can't think that momentum's going to be on their side. You mentioned, you know, momentum and being able to parlay that into more victories in the future. Well, works the other way around as well. Longzhu need all the help that they can get, honestly.
I'd be surprised if we saw this team of 5 together in summer season. They need a change somewhere. I don't know where that even is, because all their players in isolation have strong parts about them, but even if it's bringing back Cuz, who is a jungle substitute they have, who does very well in solo queue, to give Crash some competition, because when Crash falls down, there's like a lot of the strategies for Longzhu fall through as well. But a team with Fly, Prey, and Gorilla finishing, what, 7th is the potential, 6th or 7th is unacceptable.
Yeah, and it doesn't feel right either. It feels like you said, in isolation, stunning. And even watching a lot of their isolated plays as well, the things that these players can do are still at the level. It's not like we're praising players for doing something that, you know, that they're over the hill now or anything like that. It's not that situation at all. It's just when it all comes together, it doesn't necessarily work. And look at that! The LeBlanc did some work in the end. I was not expecting that damage graph. I'm not going to lie to you, Papa Smithy. It's not where I was thinking it was going to sit.
In another game, it would be empty damage and we'd be looking at a Longzhu victory, but this wasn't to be that game. And right at the end, 5-6 item LeBlanc still does some very impressive team fighting damage. Felt like I was ready to read a post-game thread about LeBlanc on 7.5 LOL, and the LOLs are gone. This was a great performance, and Guga will win the MVP. Stole the Baron, changed the game, and Longzhu will wonder how it got away from them.
Yeah, and that is the Aqua Prison to turn it all around. Guga did play fantastically well, but that was honestly almost all he needed to do, because that won them this game.
Even the Observer moused over and was like, wait, was that more than 1 point in Aqua Prison? No, just the 1 point wonder. But it was a good performance from Guga, and disengaged supports in general, apart from Tahm Kench, don't get a lot of respect, because to actually win an MVP is an utterance in itself. And this was a fight that Fly was honestly the superstar of. We're still going to show it as a Guga power play, because he was in it for a lot of time.
Yeah. He only dies at the very end of it.
Well, we show his death. Sometimes we cut away and pretend it didn't happen.
Yeah.
Oh, no, definitely died.
There it is.
Confirmed.
Slow-moed it. So nice work, Fly.
But here it was.
Oh, we were providing context for how ridiculous this is.
He shoots the Aqua Prison, and it takes so damn long that he shot it at 2,000 health.
That was almost like he coordinated with Punch.
You know how Faker...
For the sick, like, execute damage.
The famous story of Faker being like, I got this one 5 seconds before he gets a solo kill. That's what he did as he cast the Aqua Prison. He's like, this is mine. Yep. And he actually had it.
Alley-oop it for me, Punch.
And then they got the caught on catch on Fly, who couldn't afford to die. And never did we have Fly and Prey focusing on the same target. Rune Prison into Chains of Corruption, into both of them stacking damage. That sounded like a great spot for Longzhu, but it was all disorganized. At this point, they already had Ryze dead, so they could just all run at Prey. And it didn't matter if Punch lost his Guardian Angel. That was to be the game. So congratulations to Guga for his second MVP and third victory. So it actually ended up being a way better season for Kongdoo than the last time. One match win way back in spring of last year. Three match wins this season.
Even if it was looking like it was going to be awful, if you told me that Kongdoo were going to have this sort of finish a couple of weeks ago...
With that schedule.
Yeah. It's definitely not how it would be, but let's have a chat to the entire Kongdoo roster and throw it over to Joel for translation.
Thank you very much, guys. As you guys are saying, Kongdoo Monster with a feel-good victory of 2-1 against Longzhu. We are here with the entire Kongdoo organization for a team interview with these guys. 네, 공두 선수 여러분 승리 축하드립니다. Kongdoo Monster, congratulations on the win.
소감이 어떠세요?
How do you guys feel?
일단 저희 앞서서 1라운드, 2라운드 앞 경기에서 많이 져가지고.
Well, first of all, we have to mention that you know from our first round robin, even through the early stages of the second round, that we have been pretty disappointing, losing a lot of games, but feels good to get a lot of good feeling near the end. And Punch, you really were sticking with the Lee Sin today, playing it repeatedly today, but you really stood out from that performance-wise. Yeah, after the first game, you know, when I beat Crash in the jungling phase, you know, the second game, after I lost, the coach really wanted me to go back to the Lee Sin and be more aggressive. Was there a reason that you guys regressed back in the second game? It's not an excuse, but I changed the skin. I changed the skin. That's what happened. And changing that Lee Sin skin really changed everything for me. Yeah, it's but that thing really ruined everything for me from game two.
His teammates do not agree with this, by the way.
It doesn't call it an excuse, but that's what his reason for losing game two. We can have a look at a video highlight. There were a lot of very satisfying kicks on your side. Is there any tips on Lee Sin kicks? Yeah, I think it's we always have to wait for the flash, and if the opponents try to save it, you know, you'll have to go in with the right timing. So we want to have a talk with you next. Aren't you satisfied with the win today? Yeah, I'm super satisfied. And super stoked, and you know, the fact that we get a match win and a whole series win, it hasn't been for a long time. And a lot of people are really highly praising the Zephyr entrance into the organization, that you guys have been performing really well after his re-entrance to the team. Yeah, Zephyr really took care of me personally, and you know, I noticed that he took a trying to do a lot of support in my part, trying to make me better player, and that was a lot of help. And you know, him helping out with the team composition, just rebuilding the team, was really a big help to us. And Lucian is one of those picks that you really pull out in selective situations, but what is your reason for picking Lucian? Lucian's not really big on the developmental phase, but I think, you know, as time goes on, it just eventually becomes strong enough that it can contribute to the team composition, but that's kind of the reason why I picked it. And so you have mentioned this before, that you are the ace of this team. How do you think about that right now? That's still unchanged for me right now. And I think, you know, as long as my teammates cover me and, you know, take my, try to make me stronger, I can still carry for this team. And we have to continue on that. We have to talk with Edge regarding that situation. You played multiple champions today in this series and played really well. And it seemed like, you know, game three was a surprise because you picked LeBlanc that nobody else picks in the league right now. Yeah, LeBlanc is all about the item choices you build with, and taking a different approach with the items really makes LeBlanc still viable in this meta. And I think that really surprised Longzhu on their side. Yeah, laning had to be tough for you with the LeBlanc. But with Shen in the lineup and also, you know, trying to have multiple teammates trying to back you up, you guys, you know, overcame through that laning mismatch. And regardless whether it was Ahri or LeBlanc. Yeah, I think we really weren't trying to go for the mid to late game, but we were trying to be aggressive from the start and trying to get many advantages as early as we can. This could be a sensitive question, but were you preparing for this aggressive style in time for the relegation stages and hoping for the next season? Yeah, I think, you know, being passive doesn't work to my ways, and you know, I think I had to be more aggressive in this later stages to change it around. We want to talk with Roach next. You just played Shen all game and all the series. Yeah, I think I'm just satisfied that we got the win. I don't think about anything else. And Shen is still very favorable in many of the top laners in this league right now. What do you think about the champion right now? Yeah, all three laning phases were okay. And although it could have been better, but I think it just the fact that it was decent, you know, allowed me to develop and help my teammates. And I think, you know, just farming throughout the game would have actually resulted in a loss, but I'm glad that we were able to get some turnaround plays. Were you not surprised with some of the top lane picks that Longzhu pulled out today? Yeah, some of those picks were really surprising to me, and I didn't expect it at all, but I think, you know, I really owe it to my teammates for helping me pull through. Lastly, we want to talk with Guger, the savior of this series, to say the least. Yeah, I think we're, even if we're, you know, selected and confirmed for the relegations, we still want to keep our pride and, you know, trying to perform the best we can. That was our mindset going to the game. It might be a sensitive question, but you know, as the season went on, a lot of the criticism went Kongdoo's ways regarding you guys' performance. And you guys have been making many changes and making changes to your plans as well. I try not to worry about those criticisms that you're talking about. But the only thing I've been hearing is that, you know, there have been a lot of criticism. You know, I hear that from other people. But to me personally, it's not a big factor. We're just trying to always, you know, perform our best regardless of the situation. And that's just kind of how our mindset was the whole time. We were afraid that you might have been shaken by all those criticisms. And it seemed like, you know, Zyra was a staple pick for you, Guger, and was there a special reason you picked out the Nami? It was a recent practice champion for me, and I didn't get enough practice with it to, you know, pull it out, but of course Zyra would have been the best pick for me, but you know, sometimes it didn't turn out that way. And this is something we can't pull out of this question, but the Nami, I don't know if they have the video highlight prepared, but the Nami picking out the Baron in the most unlikable fashion. What was the thought going through that mind right now? We were just looking at Punch, you know, hoping that he would pull off the steal. And we were just, I was trying to help with that, you know, trying to put the Aqua person into certain champions, trying to, you know, lock up, you know, any potential distractions towards Punch, but at this moment, I had no idea what was going on, but my icon showed up, and I realized soon later, then I kind of realized that I took the Baron with the Aqua Prism, which was hardly believable. But and game 3 wasn't going to your guys' way, and ever since that Baron steal with the Nami, that turned it around. Yeah, Ryze was a big factor in that game. It was growing so well, and it was getting fed so much that, you know, if we didn't have a big turnaround, that Ryze was going to take over the game. And I think, you know, our teammates, you know, we felt like our teammates were really trampled by that fact, and, you know, we really needed a big turnaround. I'm glad we got it. Lastly, you know, even with the disappointing result of the spring split, would you like to say something to the fans out here today? I think if we pull this kind of performance much earlier in this split, I think it would have been better. But I think it's good to know that, you know, we still have this form within us, and we can continue on this and hopefully pull off more results that, you know, could keep us in this league and maybe for a more brighter future for sure. So thank you guys, everyone. So that's the end of the interview. Back over to you guys.
Thank you very much, Joel. And it's great to hear that Guger is honest. He's not saying, look, yeah, no, I planned it, planned to steal it and take away the Baron. Because personally, that's what I would have done. I said, yeah, no, we had that all sorted out. And it was aimed to be the bubble steal.
What an insane circumstance for Kongdoo Monster to win this series. And what does it say about Longzhu, who awkwardly still have another series to play later in the week? Yeah. Be interested to see if we actually do see BDD once this season, now that literally nothing is on the line. But Longzhu Gaming, we expected a lot more. Remember, they came into this series with the faint hopes of making it to playoffs, and now they leave with just the barrage of rage I'm sure is going to be directed their way by their fans. But we look at what this means, of course, nothing for Kongdoo. They could not move further than the spot they are in. Even if Jhinehae lose 2-0, they will only be negative 19, so they will be ahead of Kongdoo Monster, and Longzhu move down to 7th. Inglorious end to what has been a fairly inglorious season for Longzhu Gaming.
Yeah, and look, We'll see what they can do, but looking into the future, Papa Smithy, Freak of Freaks, going to be taking on KT Rolster. Of course, KT Rolster going to be Longzhu's final matchup, so they'll be looking on in hope that KT do some more faltering here, but KT, you have to feel still probably the favorites moving in, considering their position on the ladder. Like, how are you feeling about this? Because we're having a bit of a discussion before. I have a feeling that a Freaker are probably going to take something because they have been riding some momentum recently.
We'll talk about it more in about 15, 20 minutes, but favorites is a term that's been so much of a trap term in LCK this season. So I'm not really willing to say either. A Freaker have the form, KT have the players, but the players have not been performing.
Well, we'll see exactly what happens in our next matchup right after this break.